Hey guys, this is Pastor Scott. We're out here at Columbia Heights, Montana at the God's Ten Commandment Park, and we're going to get service started here in a little while. And as usual, I would ask that you guys pray and hit the share button. Pray and hit the share button so you can build your online community. This is your church. Add to it, pray to it, invite your friends to receive a word from the Lord. So we'll get started here as soon as Dave and the team gets in here. And let's just flip this around and we'll pray. Hi, Mama. Pray and hit the share button. Hello. So Lord Jesus, we just lift up this service to you right now in the name of Jesus. And we ask that you bless it. Holy Ghost and fire, come down from heaven and bless your children, whether they're in the tent or they watch later, Lord, on Facebook or YouTube. And we just bless you. We ask that your name be lifted up and that you guide every aspect of this service and that there will be not a word spoken unless by the power of your Holy Spirit. And we thank you for joining us here. And we thank you for your blessing and the opportunity to preach and to share and to pray and to sing songs and to come in to the presence of God. And we just thank you, Lord, and we give you glory, honor, and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, guys, and like usual, if you need anything at all, just give us a call at 1-855-70-JESUS or log on to our website at oneaccordcrusades.com. And I'm going to play a little bit of music. I checked out the recording last night. It seems as if the music from my phone plays just fine when you guys are kicking, waiting for things to happen here. So pray, hit the share button, start a watch party, whatever it is that you guys see fit, and just be blessed. Alrighty, we love you. And if you need a prayer request or something you have in need, or the Holy Ghost is telling you something, go ahead and make a comment down there. And if I see it and I can bring it up to the team, we'll be happy to make mention or pray for you right on the spot. Alrighty, God bless you guys. Pastor Scott and Diana at the Ten Commandment Park about to get started. Good, just about ready to get started. Hey, Brother Jason, we're just out here at the God's Ten Commandment Park in Columbia Heights, Montana, about ready to get started, just waiting for Pastor Dave and the team to get here. And this is night two of the Flathead Valley Revivals. The word that the Lord put on Pastor Dave's heart is revival fire. And boy, do we need it in this country and around the world for that matter. So we love you. Yeah, it is absolutely beautiful. We're just going to get started. Why don't I just turn this camera around and you'll see the beautiful tent. And it is absolutely beautiful here. Ron and Cal and the team and a couple of us set up the tent. And then the guys put all the stuff together in here. And we got some people starting to show up right now. As usual, Montana time is 7 o'clock, which means 7 or so. Not quite as bad as Kenya time, where if you say that the revival starts at 6, people don't start showing up till about 7:30. Amen. So pray and hit the share button. We love you guys. I'm going to play some tunes, and you guys enjoy. Hungry world.
Starts with me and you, then reaches out to the Lord.
Hey guys, it's Pastor Scott. Just hanging in there, just waiting on Pastor Dave and Calvin. They got called to the RV real quick. Maybe they perhaps are discussing some fine-tuning on the set list or the direction the Lord might be taking us tonight. That this is night two. We don't know exactly what is in store, but we know the Lord's going to be here and he's going to have some things for us to do. So God bless you guys, and as usual, hit the pray and hit the share button, and invite your friends, start a watch party, however it is you see fit, say, share it to a group or whatever, and we'll be up here soon as they show up.
Last minute adjustments. That's pretty nifty.
Alrighty, well there goes Cal. So like I say, we're about ready to get started. Pray and hit the share button. Share it to some groups, invite your friends, build your online community. We're here in person, but you're there in person wherever you're at. And we bless you in the name of Jesus. If you need anything at all, give us a call at 1-855-70-JESUS. And if you have a prayer request or a need, or the Holy Spirit speaking to you, go ahead and drop a comment in there. And if we see it and we feel led to say something during the service, we'll just bust out and pray for right there on the spot. But be guaranteed that we will be praying as it shows up and or later. So God bless you guys. Cal, you need anything? A wink? Oh, something to hold it down?
When old Satan comes at you, your weapons are not carnal. The blessed name of Jesus is your power.
It's always loud with you guys. Crank it up to 11. Hallelujah. Woo! Come on, Jesus. Let's do this. Hallelujah.
We can rent this land around and got some things in it. Some people taken out and some of the wind taken out. It's 13.
Oh, camping style.
Praise the Lord. Praise God, we're in revival, but I'm singing a song about camp meeting. Because we need the Lord camping in our hearts at all times.
Amen.
Praise God. Page 13.
Of God abound. There is nothing rise in glory.
Bless your holy name.
Glory to God.
You are worthy, O Lord.
Worthy to be praised. 849. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Why don't you
lift down your neck? Down into the water, there's a blessing waiting you can contain.
Way down in the water, he's pouring out the latter rain. Why don't you let down? Let down your neck and wait out in the water, he's pouring out. conflict of doubt.
And I can least convince you that Jesus owns you.
Your soul is so thirsty, so battle weary, your body's sick and tired from the pain. And it's time to get up
and stand up on the Bible
ladder rain. But don't you let down the net, down into the water, there's a blessing waiting you for the campaign. If you let down your net, way out in the water, he's pouring out the ladder rain.
Down your net,
down into the water, there's a blessing waiting you to not in pain. If you let down your net, and way
out in the water,
he's pouring out the ladder rain. When old Satan comes at you, your weapons are not carnal.
Is your power.
Remember what I called it.
And shake that old thing off in the fire. Why don't you let down your net? Down into the water, there's a blessing waiting. You can not
contain. If you let down your net and wait out of the water.
Their weapons are not carnal. The blessed name of Jesus is your power.
He cried about your children. Remember what I called it.
And shake that old stand for.
Why don't you let down your net? Down into the water. There's a blessing waiting. You cannot contain. You did let down your net.
There's a blessing waiting you cannot contain.
If you let down the net and wait out on the water, he's pouring out the ladder.
He's pouring out the ladder
rain. Why don't you let down the net?
Oh, you almost got me. I knew you were going to do that. Can't trick me no more. He got her, though.
Page 112. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Awesome. The Lord said, drink the water of him and you won't thirst no more.
Amen.
But we better stay thirsty, huh?
Oh, yeah. Woo! Thank the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Praise the Lord. Hey. Praise God. Page 112. Glory, glory, glory.
Blood-bought church. You.
Lift up their voice and sing for joy. Take your pride and be free. We're gonna glorify. Take your pride and the land and be free. Glorify the name of our God.
In the blood,
in the land,
there is power.
Ghost and power.
Praise God. We're going to sing on this night in your book.
Oh, now you're done.
Oh, man.
Man. I see how you...
Good word.
All right.
You all right with that, Scott?
Oh, yeah. Praise,
brother. Glory to God. Hallelujah. That's what we need to do in our hearts. Not only on our feet, but in our hearts. If I don't lower this down, I'll be up in the clouds. Get up, get up, get up in Jesus' name. The Lord is calling, David, to go to what he says. Don't go down to David, he's got a victory here to claim. Get up, get up in Jesus' name. Get up, get up, get up in Jesus' name. The Lord is calling, David, to go to what he says. Don't go down defeated, we've got a victory here to claim. Get up, get up, get up in Jesus' name. At the gate, they call beautiful, they laid out in the street. A poor and lonely beggar was crippled in his feet. As John and Peter passed him, they saw his need was bad. They had no gold or silver, but gave him what they had. Get up. Get up, get up in Jesus' name. The Lord is calling David to go to what they say. Don't go down to David, what a victory here to claim. Get up, get up, get up in Jesus' name. In the days in which we live, there's evil everywhere. The body's in disorder, it's been almost come to care. Well, God is calling soldiers. So get up out of your pity and grab a hold of the Holy Ghost and all the things are near.
Get up, get up, get up in Jesus' name.
The Lord is calling David to go there with the same. Don't go down the city, it's a victory here to claim. Get up, get up,
get up in Jesus' name.
Hold it forward. Get up out of your pew and grab a hold of the Holy Ghost and God.
Jesus, we bless your holy name.
Lord, our hearts be with you.
Oh, we bless you.
Lay aside everything that weighs us down and glorify you, Holy One of Israel.
Hallelujah.
Lord, I come.
Lord, I come.
Take my life. Offer it to you. A living sacrifice by your grace.
By your grace,
by your blood,
by your blood.
Come into the Holy of Holies. All I want to do
is dwell in
your presence and drink from that well that never runs dry. Just one drink in my soul, it's Glory, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You guys been on my heart there and spot. Glory to God. Hallelujah.
116. 116. Holy Ghost power.
Yeah, I was thinking that same thing a little earlier.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here.
Thank the Lord.
You got Tennessee.
You know, we're drawn by the Spirit of God, not by programs and not by announcements. We're drawn by the Spirit of God.
Amen. You got Tennessee checking in, and then Mama says that was a beautiful song.
Glory to God. Hallelujah.
It was, huh?
Hey, 116.
Page 116.
Ghost power like a mighty wind is blowing. Holy Ghost power like a mighty wind is blowing. Holy Ghost power like a mighty wind is blowing.
Revival in this land today.
Holy Ghost power like a mighty wind is blowing. Holy Ghost power like a mighty wind is blowing. Holy Ghost power like a mighty wind is blowing.
Without a way. Oh, Jesus is the same yesterday, today, forever. Waiting in faith and he still does today. And God confirmed his word with miracles and power. Now you see, God is passing this way. Holy Ghost power like a mighty wind is blowing. Holy Ghost power like a mighty wind is blowing. Holy Ghost power like a mighty wind is blowing. You're drowning in the land today. Holy Ghost power like a mighty wind is blowing. Holy Ghost power like a mighty wind is blowing. Holy Ghost power like a mighty wind is blowing. You're drowning in the land today. The
Bible
in the land today.
Praise God, hallelujah. Anybody got a testimony?
So this is my, I don't know how many years you've been coming here, but the Lord told me that I should have a child at, 47 years old, and that was 3 years ago. And I said, God, if you are talking to me, I need money, and I need something. I was leaving the house. I closed the house about a month ago, giving money to go with it, so I can say he's going to finish the promise. And I stand here with these things in my hand, knowing that I will have a child. You'll have a testimony to that. You can hear it when I come back with a baby.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus Christ, testimony.
Thank you, Lord.
Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Anybody else got a testimony? Praise God, how God's done your life. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Father.
Thank
well,
you,
I got a testimony. I'm trying to work my way up to it. I just praise God because I wouldn't be here if it wasn't His grace and mercy like all of us. And I'm just going to go back a little bit because this is why I'm standing here, is that back in 2001, I had a stroke. It took out the left side of my head, and you might still recognize that often, and it took out the whole right side of my body. My arm was pulled up like this, my face was pulled up like this, and my new Dave Barnes, but I didn't like Dave Barnes. And he came up in the hospital, and they told me that I, you know, I couldn't eat. I just got rid of everything I ate. And Dave Barnes and some others came up there and laid hands on me and prayed. Prayer works. Prayer works. When I got out of the hospital, I was using the car and start playing. Now, lending my hands like this. And I said, Lord, I can't do that. He said, I said, pick up the guitar and start playing. So I did. The other guitar I had wasn't this one. There's a lot of guitar picks in that hole right there that I lost. But I just praise God for His mercy and His goodness. And I started, after a few years, I started to run with Dave Barnes. The Lord just spoke to me in the middle of the night and said, get up and get out. In other words, get outside them four walls of our religious churches and whatever we were in and out of our own religion. And the Lord said, just get up and go and get out. I called Dave and I said, can I come and run with you? And he said, sure. And he didn't even say I prayed about it, but he told me later that he knew for 6 years that I was supposed to run with him. And so I went and I started running with him. The first trip out, we weren't doing a tent set. We were going to build furniture and deliver it to wherever it was going, somewhere in Arkansas. And when I started to go, I got, and I'm saying this because maybe you're wrestling a physical problem, and I started to go, and two tumors popped up on me overnight, big tumors, one big as a banana, the other one big as an orange. And I told Dave, I said, I can't go. I got to go to Phoenix, Arizona, to the VA hospital. I said, something's wrong. And so that night, I was asleep. I was lived in a little house separate from Dave and his wife. And a big dark spirit stood in the corner of my bedroom. and I was dying. I couldn't do nothing about it. I was dying. And at 2 o'clock in the morning, Dave came through the front door. The Holy Ghost told him, "You get up there. This spirit is attacking him." And so he came out up there and he rebuked that spirit. And the next day I said, "I'm going with you because the Lord spoke to me." He says, "As you go, I will heal you." We got to step out in faith. You know, I don't know about Israel and Moses, but I did know what the Lord said. "Moses, as you go, I'll deliver you. I will train you. I will teach you." Step out. Moses cried, "God, I can't do this for this reason, this reason, and this reason." And the Lord said, "Why are you crying to me? What's in your hand? What do we got in our hand? Holy Ghost power, the word of the living God, the faith of Jesus Christ, our Savior and our deliverer." And I just thank God for His love and for His mercy. Glory to God. We're going to do another song called "Greater Is He in Me," page 115. Glory to God, page 115. Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Let's start with the chorus.
Greater, greater, greater is He than me. I'm singing, I'm shouting, I'm happy and I'm free. I'm a soldier in an army that never has known defeat. Greater, greater, greater is He than me. Yes, greater, greater,
greater is He than me. I'm so near,
I'm shouting, I'm happy and I'm free. I'm a soldier in an army that never has known defeat. Greater,
healing me.
I took the challenge when I said that I would stay. I knew it wouldn't be an easy thing, but it messed up changing plan. God gives me daily strength to stand in victory. The power of Him may come my way. Greater is He in me. Yes,
greater, greater,
greater is He in me. I'm singing, I'm shouting, I'm happy and I'm free. Soldier in an army that never has known defeat. Greater, greater, greater is He in me. I took the challenge when I said that I would stand. I knew it wouldn't be an easy thing, cause it has been Satan's plan. God gives me daily strength to stand in victory. The powers of hell may come my way. Greater is He in me. Yes, greater, greater, greater is He in me. I'm singing, I'm shouting, I'm happy and I'm free. I'm a soldier in an army that never has known defeat. Greater, greater, greater is He in me. So long I wandered in this social world alone. Heartbreaking, so much failure was a battle never known. Own Son Jesus, who listened to my plea. Now my life has a brand new chapter. Greater is He in me. Yes, greater, greater, greater is He in me. I'm singing, I'm shouting, I'm happy and I'm free. I'm a soldier in an army that never has known defeat. Greater, greater, greater is He in me. I took the challenge when I said that I would stand. I knew it wouldn't be an easy thing, but the best of Satan's plan. God gives me daily strength to stand in victory. So tired of Him may come my way. Greater is He in me. Yes, greater, greater, greater is He in me. I'm singing, I'm shouting, yeah, I'm happy and I'm free. Soldier in an army that never had known defeat. Greater, greater, greater is He in me. Yes, greater, greater, greater is He in me.
Praise God, hallelujah. Thank you, Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Anybody else got a testimony?
A song? Anybody else want to
song? Anything?
Glory, glory, glory.
Lord, open us up, Father.
Glory to God. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Part 75.
Thank you, Lord, for prayer. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Glory to God. Got a river of life flowing out of me. Makes a lame to walk and the blind to see. Opens prison doors, takes a captive free. I've got a river of life flowing out of me. Drink up, oh well. And my soul, drink up, oh well. Make me whole, oh, oh, bring up so well, and give to me that life abundantly. I've got a river of life flowing out of me. Makes a lame to walk and the blind to see. Open prison doors, it's a captive free. I've got a river of life flowing out of me. Spring up away in my soul. Spring up away and make me whole. Spring up away and give to me that life abundantly. Spring up away in my soul. Bring up a well in my soul, bring up a well and make me whole, bring up a well and give to me that life abundantly.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Lord, hallelujah.
Glory, hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Glory to God. Thank
Father
you,
Father God. I just thank you. I praise you.
Praise God, hallelujah. I know, Dave, they keep putting the song book down.
That's all right. That's,
have you got room for one little spot?
Yes, we do. Yes, we do. Yes, sir. Huh? Yeah. It won't squeak. Sorry. It shouldn't.
Brothers and sisters, I just want you to know when you sing and play on the instrument, Psalm 55:22 says, cast thy burden upon the Lord. Cast. Tashlik. To cast. Cast it away. Let it be destroyed. Stomp on the head of the snake. Let it be dead. Cast. Cast. Now let's go back here and learn what we're casting away. Thy burden upon the Lord, cast thy burden upon the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. He shall sustain thee. He shall never suffer the righteous to be ruined.
Yes.
And in 1 Peter 5:7, casting all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. In COVID, in every crisis, in every detail of our lives, God tells us to be sustained in him. He will never suffer the righteous to be ruined. Cast your care upon him, for he cares for you.
Amen.
We don't go fishing for our cares again. Casting and reeling them in. Yeah. Cast them away.
She just passed it off. Boom.
Yep.
Somebody walked out of my salon, walked out of their appointment, refuses to respond to me because of a comment that was made about Democrat or Republican. We live in
those times, you know. And I'm not even sure if she ever will respond again. But here's the deal. I did what was right. I called her. I apologized. You know, I'm not even sure.
Right.
I still don't even know if that's the reason she walked out, right? But I want to be right before the Lord. And I asked the Holy Spirit to just go before me. And then I was standing in the bathroom, and all of a sudden my phone turns on, and this song is playing about where are you when the darkness comes. And you know what? I knew that was sent from the Holy Spirit tonight. I knew it was. I went home. I wasn't even going to come. I changed my mind. I wasn't going to come. I was like, I'm just going to go home, real hard.
Where are you at, girl?
Right? But I didn't have to know. I didn't lie. I didn't have to know what I was about. But because you texted me, then I came too. So I know that, you know, it was just hurting each other up. It's encouraging one another to get worse. It's allowing God to take care of the business for me instead of letting that incident drag me down and break me for the rest of the night or even the week. Because I'm not personally sensitive, you know, about other people's feelings and care about my clients. But God also showed me, we're in that season. And God will restore what's supposed to be restored. And He'll remove what's supposed to be removed. So, you know what? Thank you for listening, and just thank you for being encouraging.
You're good. You don't got nothing to apologize for.
All right.
I obey God.
Cassie, back at it. Praise God.
For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war in the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down, to the destruction of strongholds. Casting down imaginations and
every high thing that exalts itself
against the knowledge of God.
Yes.
And bringing into captivity
every thought.
Amen. Every thought to the
obedience of Christ.
And having in readiness to avenge all of his obedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Praise God.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Anybody else?
I think Brother Calvin can relate with this one. We had a meeting in the office the other day, and I had read this verse the night before, Mark chapter 4. If you want to turn with me in your Bibles, that's fine. If not, that's fine. I'll read it too. Mark chapter 4, verse 17. And have no root in themselves, so endure but for a time. Afterward, when affliction or persecution ariseth for the word's sake, immediately they are offended. So easily we can be offended. Sister, you said you weren't going to show up. The same thing, very similar, happened to me just a few days ago. We've been out here serving for about 2-3 months, here every day, every morning, and we try our best to be kind to the customers and the people coming in and have a word ready and be prayed up and such. And someone had came through the park here, and we got in a little discussion, and I didn't know how big a deal it meant to her, those ladies that came in, but it happened to do with the mask, right, Pastor Dave? Whether you should have one or you shouldn't have one. And I just said, you know, whether you do or you don't, it's okay. But apparently I had said something to offend her, and the word got back to Philip and Susie, and we had a little talk after the day's done. And I pour my heart, and me and my wife spend time in here every day, and we try to make the place look nice, and we want things to go right for everybody. But then one little thing that someone says can mess everything up. And that day that happened, and then another thing happened, and Brother Barnes came in and he said, "Hey bro, this or that, you're not gonna like what I'm gonna say." And I said, "I don't like what most people say," you know? And I had the little talk with Dave and had a little talk with Phil, and all these things were starting to really piss me off. So much so that I was like, you know what? I'm over that tent. before the tent was even up. I wasn't even interested in it. Now, I was pointed to this scripture, and having no root in themselves, and so endure but for a time. Afterward, when affliction and persecution ariseth for the word's sake, immediately they are offended. I was that guy, but I went back a verse and I noticed this in verse 16. And these are they that likewise went on stony ground, who when they have heard the word,
give him the other mic,
immediately receive it with gladness. That's me. I received the word. I'm in the word. I received God's word years ago, and I came into this whole ministry excited, fired up for Jesus, but then having no root in myself. As soon as I get offended, I'm ready to run. How easy is it for us to just turn away? Brother Calvin shared with me how he had a moment like that, right, Cal? You can relate with this. I think we were all going through it before this tent set even happened, right, Pastor Dave? You guys had your time at it.
Yeah.
And if the devil had his way, we wouldn't be here right now.
That's right.
And
that's right.
The world wants us to get offended. They want us to get us in these little squabbles about Democrat or Republican or no mask or a mask or you should do it this way or you should vote for Trump or all that stuff. It doesn't matter. What matters is lifting up the name of Jesus.
Right.
And I knew inside my heart of hearts that once we got the tent up, and once Calvin hit that first song, we started, and Pastor Dave started praying and casting down things and preaching and sharing the word, that all that would be lifted. You found the same thing out tonight, right? You didn't want to come here. I was ready to go. I told Diane, I'm done with all of this. I'm cool with the Ten Commandment part. Maybe we'll come back next year. We got all this stuff. It just hit all within these past few days. Go figure. The tent's being set up. Things are about to happen, and the devil doesn't want us to do it. So I guess what I'm trying to say is, when you push through, I heard it once said that it's where the offense is, where you get offended, say this is the line, and you push past that, that's where the blessing is.
Yeah.
Right here is where you were, and to get to the blessing, you got to push past into that zone to grab it, but the devil knows that it's there. And he doesn't want you to get to it, because when you're on the other side, you look back at your offense and you go, ah, I see you. Those are just words. They're going to sting for a little while. But once you get through it, you look back and you go, wow. See what God did? See what God's doing? See what God's going to do? No wonder we're fighting through this stuff, right, Dave? No wonder we have these attacks.
Yeah.
So if anyone's feeling down or you're feeling tired or you just feel like you can't go on, just push through to that next level. Just push through past the veil. Push through the offense and push through what people would have you to feel about yourself. Get it all aside. Get it all away and move past and move in to where God wants you to be. Amen. Hallelujah. Go ahead, brother. Amen. Praise the Lord.
I put God send you.
Praise God, hallelujah. We're not in the song book here, but there's verses you might know. If not, they're easy to know. Blessed wonderful name of Jesus. Blessed
wonderful name of Jesus. Blessed that wonderful name of Jesus. No other name I know. There is power in the name of Jesus. There's power in the name of Jesus. There's power in the name of Jesus. No other name I know. There's healing in the name of Jesus. There's healing in the name. In the name of Jesus, there's salvation in the name of Jesus.
Jesus, no other name I know. Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him in the morning, praise Him in the noontime. Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him when the sun goes down. Praise Him, praise Him, we'll praise Him in the morning, praise Him in the noontime. Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him when the sun goes down. Yes, love Him, love Him, oh, love Him in the morning, love Him in the noontime. Love Him, love Him, love Him when the sun goes down. Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him in the morning, praise Him in the noontime. Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him when the sun goes down. Yes, praise Him, serve Him, oh, serve Him in the morning, serve Him in the noontime. Serve Him, serve Him, serve Him when the sun goes down. Yes, exalt Him, exalt Him, exalt Him in the morning, exalt Him in the noontime. Exalt Him, exalt Him, exalt Him when the sun goes down.
Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Anybody else got anything?
We thank you, Lord. We bless your holy name.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
I'll
say something.
You bet.
Here, Josh.
There you go, John.
Thank you, God.
Glad to see you, sir.
Great to see you, Dan. Just to follow up on what you said, Scott, for James 1, verse 12, sorry, verse 12, blessed is the man who endures temptation. For when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life which the Lord has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Then when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, brings forth death. Do not be deceived, my beloved brethren. So I really fixed on that word enticed. And that word enticed means bait in the Greek.
Yes.
You know, and when the offense comes, we're being enticed to let loose, you know, to give in to our wrong desires. You know, we want to prove ourselves right. You know, we want to express what's in our hearts. And but there's another scripture that can help with that. It's Proverbs 19:11. It says, the discretion of a man makes him slow to anger, and his glory is to overlook a transgression. And I think this is another scripture where it says it's to the glory of a man to do anything. And so, in advance, we should be, you know, with the mindset that I'm going to overlook anything that comes my way. If it's an offense, I'm going to overlook it, because who cares if I'm right or not? What matters is if Jesus is right, if he is correct about something. We need to glorify him. And we can glorify him by overlooking those offenses. And if we let an offense take hold, it can become a stronghold. Because it says that the sin, when it's conceived and becomes full grown, it brings forth death. And that's when the stronghold develops. And that can separate people for years or decades. Just one little offense,
yep.
One little seed that the devil planted in your garden, and then the weeds take over, and there's no garden anymore because you're angry about it all the time.
True that.
It's in there and never goes away. And but we can be free. That's the good news. We can be free from every offense. Jesus can set us free. And it says that, you know, when the strong man, he's in his palace, you know, his goods are at peace. But when a stronger than he comes and overcomes him, he destroys the armor in which he trusted and divides his spoil. And that's the stronghold. All we have to do is just surrender that thing to the Lord and say, God, I'm done with this. I'm going to do it your way. And then Jesus will come in and demolish that thing. And we'll be free. And so we don't have to be offended. We should be forgiven. So that's what I got.
Woo! Thank you, Lord.
Woo! Just threading it together.
It says that those that are led by the Spirit, they are the sons of God. So what's that say about those that aren't led by the Spirit, or those that think they're led by the Spirit?
Oh, come on now.
Okay? You know, God is amazing how he brings things together, how he puts things together, how he brings one to another, how he puts a word in one's heart and another word in another heart and another word in another heart, another word in another heart, another word in another heart, and he brings it all together. But God is the maker of all things. So why are we so astonished by what God does? He said he's going to do it. He said, I shall pour out my spirit on some flesh, right?
No, all flesh.
What?
All flesh.
All flesh. What's wrong with these mics? All flesh.
A little tempty tonight.
So what's he saying? Are you not part of all flesh? Why are we not? Now, I'm not trying to get honest. I'm trying to get us to realize that the Spirit of God is moving and God is trying to bring something forth, put something into position, and bring something forth. If we're going to run in revival, we've got to have the ground, our own ground. Now listen to me. All right? Our own ground has to be prepared for what God is going to bring. Because during the midst of a revival, God is going to bring that which plants. He's going to bring watering. But at the same time, the Holy Spirit is going to bring increase. If we're not willing to allow our ground to be plowed, because that's what God means to do, my goodness. If we're not willing to allow our ground to be plowed, because what revival is about is your ground, whether you know it or not, being plowed. It's about us being, but sometimes God brings people through to bring encouragement and strength. You know, no one really has any understanding of what it took to pull the tent out, go get it and pull it back where it was. And along the way, I took the Holy Spirit to encourage me. All right? I don't want to put nobody down. I want you to realize something. What I'm watching here tonight, I'm sitting in my chair and I'm praying and I'm crying out to God and I don't realize what time it is. And I look down in my watch and it says, or at my phone, and it says about 7:40. I said, I didn't get all out of shape, okay? Because I figured God was doing something. I couldn't tell if there was something going on or wasn't going on. What am I saying to you? But God, see, God already had it all. All right? We're too worried about our program. We're too worried about our planning. And actually, if you look back, the Bible says we ought not plan. This ought not be. All right? And basically what it's saying, he's saying it's a sin, is what he's saying. And there's a reason. Because if we're instant in season and instant out, and we're going to obey God, and we're going to do what God has said do, then we're going to have to be pliable. At the moment they got, is there not a verse that says that we're to be instant in season? So how are you going to be instant in season if you've already got it all planned? See, we're in a season, and God has showed us this, okay? Everybody, everything's had a plan, and they got this, and they got that, and this court date is set, and this is set, and all of a sudden, all of that comes to a halt. Government shutting down in some ways. The church, to those that closed their doors, they were all crying about whatever. And now we find ourselves in a place that some of them didn't have a church to go to. I'm saying something on purpose. Do you know how many people were not prepared? Do you know how many people's hearts were not in the right place? And God had, they had not allowed God to plow their ground? Because they're in a field. When you set a crop, you plow. I came out of the farming and cattle and sheep and orchards and things like that. I came out of that realm. And so when you're bringing something forth and you're preparing the ground, there come certain ground, certain things that grow, take certain nourishment or nutrition out of the ground. And so in the Bible, it talks about in the seventh year, the ground was laid and allowed to rest. I want us to get a hold of something. I was allowed to rest. Why? So that the earth, the dirt, could replenish. So that was needed for other things to grow. But today we keep it going, and how we keep it going is by putting unnatural things into the soil. Alright? We have all kinds of plants that come forth. Today we have hybrid corn. Alright? Hybrid corn gets within approximately a mile thereabouts of another field of old corn. It will blow over and cause that corn, that seed in that corn, to not reproduce. Alright? What's happening in the church world often is that is coming through. It's coming through in a manner, and it's hybrid. And so it blows, a wind blows across, and it blows over onto my field. And what it does is puts me in a position that which is happening, now my corn the next year I go and plant, and it doesn't bring forth the crop that I thought it should, is because I've been tainted. Okay? I'm going somewhere on purpose. Because I don't believe God is trying to do something here. I know for a fact God is trying to do something here. And I think in your knowers of knowers, so do you. See, it's up to us. It's up to whether I allow my ground to be plowed. I may have preached for 43 years, and I have. I've had sessions that I preached 1,200 and 1,300 services nonstop. My body has, I preached so hard and so long that my body would want to shut down. But when I would come to the platform, God would reshoot me. He'd replenish me with whatever I needed at that moment. I'm not bragging. That is not what I'm doing. I'm saying that God means for you to be wore out. Because when you're wore out, here's what happens. You have to depend on the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You have to depend on the one, Jesus. When you've got the strength to do it, when you can just do it, if we're not careful, we're just doing. And we're going through we're just going through the motion. I want to be that which God has planted in. And I want my crop that God is going to bring. I want that crop to be everything that God has called it to be. I don't want my crop to be far. I don't want to come preach because I want to preach. I didn't want to preach last night, and I didn't want to preach tonight. I didn't care. In other words, was what I said. Because there's a stirring going on in us. And God is trying to plow my field. God is trying to plow your field. God is trying to disturb some of the old things and get the old things out of the way. But we will allow him to get the old things out of the way, then the new things cannot come forth. We're afraid of moving out of our comfort zone. But the Holy Ghost says, move. I want to be led by the Spirit of God, as it says in Romans. I want to come to that place. I don't want to just quote scripture. I'm not interested. I'm not interested. I'm interested in quoting scripture under the anointing that destroys the yoke, but I'm not interested in quoting the Logos word. I'm interested in bringing a Rhema word. A Rhema word, it means that it comes forth under the power and the unction of the Holy Ghost. It is not just a scripture that is read. It is not just something that is said. It comes forth with burning power. It comes forth with Holy Ghost and fire. See, precedence was set. I watched it. I heard it. I heard it from what you read. I heard it from what you said. I heard it from what all you said. I heard it from where you were. I felt something in the spirit begin to turn. I felt my field begin to be quiet. I felt another section of the field that God said, okay, I've given you a crop and now it's ripe. Now hand it out. Are you with me tonight?
Amen.
I'm excited about what God is doing. I see what's going on in the nation, maybe more than anybody realizes. But I know this, that a man of war does not entangle himself with affairs of this life, that he may please. I don't want to be a sheep. I want to be a warrior. I don't want to quit before my time. You two were in last night. When you prayed for me sitting over there, you hit me right on. Body, I'm weary. And even my mind at times. But what I needed is strength. And when God showed me there was revival in my life, I could have stopped halfway. I'm not saying I'm bringing it. I'm saying whoever brings it's going to be the Holy Ghost, or it better be the Holy Ghost. I'm sick of fake revivals, and I can call them out for you if you'd like. I want a real move of the Holy Spirit. If I do, nothing can sit by me, but allow me. Allow me to be encouragement and strength for the body which wrestles to try to find its way. Don't let me be so pompous, Lord, that those that are bragging and those that are down, and I heard from some of them today. Don't let me, Lord, to say, well, you just got to have some faith. Don't let me go there, Lord, because that's foolishness. But, Lord, let me have compassion. My heart. Lord, plow this old heart. Plow it, Holy Spirit. Set your plow deep, Lord. Turn over what needs to be turned over. Release us in the Holy Ghost. Don't let us fall back. Some of us have came forth weary. I walked into the salon. I'll probably use this for weeks. I could feel a heaviness. But over the top of the heaviness that I could pick up on the Holy Ghost. I felt a power. I felt an anointing. I felt a joy. I felt a strength. I felt the Holy Ghost moving like fire. I'll sit in such a purpose. see, you're going to be discouraged. And then act like this Christian, you shouldn't be. You need to shut up. And you need to get on your face before the Lord of Israel. And you need to recognize that discouragement shall come. Moses was discouraged. There was a session where Paul was discouraged. There's a session. He says, we were given up. We were already given. We figured we were going to die. He said, I go through this for your sake. When I came to the Lord, when you came to the Lord, my life was no longer mine. It was belong to Him. That means that everything that I do needs to be centered and focused on Christ. I've had to walk away from family things. I've had to leave family behind. My wife has given up everything, even family. She's had to walk out, but the Bible says that's what we'll have to do. He says, I've not come to bring peace, as they say. I've come to bring a sword. And that word sword there means division. But man, we can preach across the pulpit of God ain't a God of division. Excuse me, you better rephrase that. Because I'm going to tell you something. You're not an author of confusion, really. You're misinterpreting. What do you think happened in Gideon, the army below Gideon? And who said it? God. They reared up amongst themselves and killed one another. What he isn't an author of is those that walk under the anointing of God. Those that walk under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. He is not an author of confusion. Why is there so much doctrine and so many things that are coming forth that it seems like, man, where is all this coming from? Because man hasn't allowed God to plow his field. Sometimes you may seem and feel as though you're all alone. But he says to Elijah, there's 7,000 who have not bowed their knee. And I promise you, in Montana alone, there are more than 7,000. I'm saying something on purpose. I may see the revival, but do I doubt God? I may see that God doing something in me, but am I more concerned about doing what I want? Am I more concerned about doing this or that? Or am I busy being? Because let me tell you something. Paul says that I have not everything. I have not arrived. I press towards the mark of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. You know what's going to take? Because you and I, oh, some of us are pressed. That's not what I'm saying. But it's going to take another press. It means that even though I'm tired, even though I'm weary, even though things don't look just exactly right, it means because even though you're broke, even though there's nothing seems to be right, it seems like everything's going wrong, that I got to press. And that means that everything is going to come up as you begin to press to try to distract you from what God wants you to do. The first thing that's going to come up is my own feelings. I'm going to try to distract me from what God wants. I wasn't saying I didn't want to preach as I didn't want to preach. But I was saying, Lord, I want to move with your Holy Spirit. And if it means I sit it out, I sit it out. But Lord, if it means I step up, then I step up. I preached my life out. I preached to a point there was almost nothing left. I didn't stand, I had to sit. I know what the anointing does to the body. It wears you whether you know it or not. God is a strengthener, but let me tell you something. The human body is affected by the anointing. And God may strengthen me in the morning. And he may strengthen me in the night. He may strengthen me in the evening. He may strengthen me. But if I'm not willing to come to where God wants me to come to, then what is it that I expect to be called one who has been led by the Spirit? If no weapon that is formed against me shall prosper, in Isaiah 54:17, if no weapon that is formed against me shall prosper, and every tongue that shall rise up against thee in judgment thou shalt condemn, it ain't you condemning it with your tongue. It's you going to prayer and not with God. It's you and I leaving it in the parish. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord. There and their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. But then there's another verse that says the righteous are scarcely saved. See, let's balance. Let's keep things in balance. We're not careful, see, because all of a sudden God begins to encourage me, and he comes to come in and meet, and the devil comes and stops. You see, if we're standing where we're supposed to be, there'll be some of us who'll say, wait a minute, I hear someone in trouble. Wait a minute, I hear someone discouraged. Lord, I hear a broken heart. Lord, I sense there's some deliverance that needs to come forth. Lord, I sense the Holy Ghost giving what I need. And you begin to pray, we'll get down on our face and cry out in the Holy Ghost. And if I have the faith of a mustard seed, believe in my heart and doubt not. God says, if you speak to the mountain, I'm commanded to be cast in the sea, and it will obey. You see, he never promised me that it'd be easy. In fact, he told me it'd be difficult. He promised me it'd be simple. That's so simple that I would try to get my mind around it. And because it's so simple, I can't get my mind there. See, as a man, I'm an analyzer. And there, I've been blessed very much. I can't figure it out. But see, it don't work in the spirit. I've got to shut that old thing down in my mind. I've got to bring every vein into what? I've got to bring it in to captivity. See, because I want to figure it out. I want to know exactly what God is doing. All I heard God say is, I want you to go to the street. I want you to set the tent. I want you to go to the street. And God began to show me something happening. He didn't give me one dream. He gave me three dreams. So Sunday, I'm going out in front of Alan's place. Can't remember what is it? Garden of Eden. Sunday and Monday both. Before service. I don't know what time yet, I'm just waiting on the Holy Ghost. We're gonna find some other places to just take prayer and praise. I'm gonna believe what God said. You see, I'm gonna have to allow in the meantime, as I'm believing, I've got to allow my field to be blocked. See, there's one field that you're being plowed in, and there's another field that's coming to cross. I'm not just jumping. I'm in a vein. I'm saying something on purpose. Because, see, there's a piece that's going to be plowed because it's getting ready for another planting. There's another piece that harvest is fixing to come forth. See, there's more than just the harvest. The harvest is glorious, as they want to preach. But see, some of that has to do, the harvest is plenteous and the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore that the Lord of the harvest send forth the harvesters. Oh, I hear him quote all the time. I hear him all the time. Oh, the harvest is great. You know, and the laborers are few, but they never bothered to quote the next part of it. Lord, pray ye therefore that the Lord of the harvest send forth the harvest. You know what I need? I need the Lord to send forth his harvesters into my life to harvest that which is ready to be harvested. But get what I just said. See, that we need to get out of the shallow water. We need to come into a realm of death. That verse signifies that out there, there may be those that are ripe, but he's signifying there's a crop in you that is ready. And then it needs to be harvested. If you don't take and allow God to bring forth the harvest, to bring forth the harvest, and the harvester is the Holy Ghost. That's the harvester. It brings it forth. And in a wheat combine, it takes it, puts it in a, it blows off the shaft. It brings it out and it puts it in a piece in the combine, and then they put it in another trailer, and that trailer hauls it over, or they pull up a semi, or they haul that over to another semi. See, God doesn't mean for you to have a partial load. He means for you to have a full load. He means for the combine, he means for the Holy Ghost combine to come forth. through, and the harvest to be more than enough. It means that so much is balled up, that God has already put so much in you, that he wants to bring something out of you.
Yeah.
Woo! Come on, preach it, brother.
That's revival. Let's get it right. I understand what they're saying, but I want more depth than that. I want to understand the Lord. There's something he's had in my life. There's some things that need to be harvested. Lord, the Holy Spirit is the only one that can harvest him. The only one that can harvest him. See, I don't even know whether the Lord could see from us. But I have my moments of discouragement that are real. And we've heard a faith message turned sideways so much that we can't even say, you know what, I'm in a moment, I'm just discouraged. My Bible says the truth shall set you free. I'm going to tell you what. No, don't. I hear those that name it and claim it in whatever bracket, okay? I've been there. Well, don't admit you're sick. I says, okay, so when you break your leg, don't admit you have a broken leg. Don't face that. Get up and walk! That's what that statement says. See, sometimes we need to have some compassion to just sit down and listen to where somebody is and say, yes, you may need a greater room of faith, but look at what God is doing. Because see, we're in the church is in a season that it says tribulation cometh forth, and the tribulation bringeth patience, and patience bringeth what? It bringeth experience, and experience bringeth hope. And if you don't have tribulation, there is none of the other three. Period. So the church of America, the church even of the world, is in a realm right now that tribulation is upon it. And what God is trying to do is get us, and get us as Holy Ghost people, to stand back and realize, Lord, I need to walk through this tribulation. Lord, my eyes need to be turned up to you, and I need to know that Jesus is the answer, and I am not the answer. I don't need to focus on everything else. I need to focus on Jesus Christ. And if I focus on Jesus Christ, then God can bring forth the harvest that needs to come forth. If I won't focus on Christ, if I won't get my focus straight, if everything else I'm focused on. Because see, I'm going to say something, and some of you may not like it, but it'll get you up out of your religious chair. I'm talking to you, Facebook. This that's on the planet right now, God sent. As he sent the plagues to Egypt. Oh, get it straight. Don't you text me. Don't bother to Facebook me. Take a hold of it. Swallow hard, because pride says God didn't send it. Why? Because he let loose a spirit of fear upon a country, upon a world, to allow the church to move into a whole different place. Because if he hadn't, the church wouldn't come out of the four walls, because there's a harvest that needs to come forth. And God says, I want to send forth my Holy Ghost harvester. Nobody else is getting them out of this tonight. I am.
I love it.
Oh, but brother, he allowed it. No, he said with Saul, he says, after Saul had sinned, he sent a evil spirit unto Saul. He didn't say he allowed the devil to. Don't turn and twist the word where you want it. Wasn't the devil that sent the plagues to Egypt?
Just saying.
It was God. God's trying to get us up into a whole new place so that revival can come forth. I know that's contradicting to the much as being preached. Oh well. See, by the way, more than once have I had the Lord tell me when I broke down, and I'm trying to rebuke the devil. He says, well, what the devil is meaning? What? Yeah. He stalked me for 3 years in Oregon. I kept trying to go, and the Lord had told me, you're going to stay. And I said, Lord, I know I'm going to stay, but that's going to be a little bit, right? So I kept trying to leave. Am I wrong, Trina? You were part of them. And I was just, so I break down out in the middle of the lot, and I'm walking around my trailer, and I'm, I rebuke that thing in the name of Jesus. I call it down, I cancel something. All of a sudden, I hear a voice, an audible voice out of heaven. Why are you rebuking me? Well, I knew it was the Lord. He says, I broke you down because I mean now. I don't mean for you to come back later. I say, Lord, I break a spring on my RV. I'm in Minnesota, and nobody wants to work on my truck at all. It'll be 5 or 6 days. I said, okay, Lord, I guess I got to do it. See, I didn't start rebuking the devil. I want you to get a hold of something. We give the devil way more glory than he's there. He's there. I said, Lord, you must be doing something. And up pulls a truck beside me. He says, sir, were they able to help you? I says, no, sir. He says, well, let me run across the street. He got me a place to go work on it before it was done. Just as I finish tearing up myself under the trailer, because that's what it was, cleaning my hands off a hand cleaner, I look up and there's two girls almost in a run coming across the parking lot. I said, Lord, I knew you had a race. See, we're busy blaming things that the devil just likes us. The devil goes, I don't have to do nothing because they think it's real. So what's he do? He mocks us. Why do we not have more strength than God? It's because sometimes we're looking down the wrong avenue. We're looking at it from the wrong way. Maybe we're going down a one-way street the wrong direction. And God is saying, I want you to turn back and I want you to go the right way. See, the Spirit of God is to lead us. Everybody with me? How many of us need harvest in our life? And with only one that can do it, it's the Holy Ghost. Oh, I know the fields are ripe. I'm from border to border. I've gone across this country. I can see that the fields are ripe. You see, until I get concerned about my field, until I recognize that my field needs to be harvested, and that there may be something in my field that needs to be harvested, now, what do I got? Because now God sends a Holy Ghost grain bin with me, and it's full. And when somebody needs, it says under that tree, he says, those that grow up by the rivers of living water, they shall grow out their branches. Their branches shall grow. Their leaves shall never cease. Even in the heat, in the time of drought. And when they get old, they shall still bring forth fruit. There shall not be just a season. They shall always be in season. That's the Holy Ghost. That's the remnant that God's talking about. That's the remnant that God's moving on right now to be able to come forth. Everybody getting what I'm saying?
Amen.
See, because what prompted it was what all you had to say. Because when I came in, I had nothing. You with me? You get what I'm saying? What happened was some of what was being harvested out of you got given to me. If there isn't a harvest in your life, how can I hand you what you need? If there isn't something that I have that has been harvested, how can I hand it to you? You know what that does? It brings others to the realization, wait a minute, maybe I have something. Oh, wow. Man, I just heard the voice of it. I hear him saying, I don't know what God said. He said,
and set you alone. You don't have sin.
No, I don't know what you're saying.
See, we become silent. So what happens is I miss out on the harvest. That means we harvest to me. And someone else doesn't get their harvest either. I must become a light that I have not put in under the bushel. What a powerful time. I can feel it. I was trying to remember the last time I have felt what I've felt for such a degree. I have wept for days. I can't even talk to you hardly without crying. And it ain't because I'm all broken up. It's because there's something going on. There's a stirring and there's a field being plowed. There's an harvest coming forth, and I know that it's ready. Because he said, I'll let the prophets know. See, we're all looking for coming, I understand. But what about the coming right now? What about the coming of Christ that came in you? What about the God, the Christ in you, the hope of glory? What about the word of God that says the kingdom of God lays within the man? That means I've got to allow it to come out of the man. That's why I must bring all the imagination into captivity. That's why I must allow, not allow some of it. I shouldn't even get into some of the conversations that want to come forth.
Yep, right. So true.
I'm the anti-mask guy that God said make the mask. What?
I got one right here.
Put my name on your face and it'll be in their face. I'm like, oh my Lord Jesus. Amen. And I got testimony after testimony after testimony of a stupid mask.
They're flying off the
shelves. There's a hard mask. They're flying off the shelf.
They're flying off the shelf.
I'm saying some word. They're just, God's got something going on that's beyond you and me. And he says, I'll take the foolish.
Call the wise. And you're talking about a salon, too.
Oh, yeah.
Mask and a salon.
And a salon.
That's the big story of the tent revival so far. What the...
You come out and you start praying this morning. I caught you coming on the porch. I'm like, oh Lord, there's some up. I feel churning. I feel something a turning, Lord. I feel something going on. See, because I need prayer. She goes over and lays hands on the side of my trailer. I'm not trying to lift nobody up. I'm lifting up the Holy Ghost that's in them. I'm not trying to lift up the hair salon. I'm trying to lift up the Holy Ghost that was in the hair salon. Okay, I'm trying to look and say, Lord God, you are the leader. Those that are led by the Holy Spirit, they are the sons of God. Not those that think they're led by the Holy Spirit, but those that are led by the Holy Spirit, that God stops you dead in your track and breaks your rig down. Blows my, allows my truck to blow up. I'm headed from Oregon into California. And I bought another old truck. We're going down the road and all of a sudden we're doing a gallon of oil in 100 miles. Pretty soon I'm at a gallon and a half at 60. And the Lord says to me, you keep ministry rolling no matter what. I had no clue what he was saying. Actually, before the truck started to act that way, God told me, did you prepare? But you look. You keep ministry rolling no matter what. I get into my destination and my truck blows up. I go, Lord, I ain't got a truck. The Lord says, yeah, but you got to set a tent. You got to take the tent down. And there's a camp meeting. You'll be 3 weeks, so quit worrying about it. I'm thinking, oh, wow. I'm thinking, what am I going to do, Lord? I take the time and I start looking, and the Lord says, just start glancing at trucks. But instead, I started really looking at trucks. 5,000 trucks later, literally. I said, Lord, what are you doing? And he said, I said, you have several weeks here. Have I not always provided? Have I not always brought you what was needed? See, God was plowing a field at the same time, was bringing forth a harvest. See, he's multitasks. I mean, all over the place. See, that place that God begins to ring, and all of a sudden, we're down to the last, we brought the tent down. He said, okay, Lord, I'm just, what do you want me to do? I'm waiting. And I hadn't looked at nothing for about a week. All of a sudden, something stirred up inside of me and said, go. The car guru now. I opened up my phone and went to car guru, and the first page come up on the dock. I looked at it. It's in Idaho. I got my hot rods. I can't get Idaho. I'm halfway down in California. I'm saying something on purpose. Because unless there's some trials, unless there's some troubles, that revelation of faith can never come forth. Unless you are tried, because the word says that you shall be tried in the word. He's not talking about the Logos word. He's talking about you shall be tried in the ring of it. So I'm sitting there, okay. I call him and I says, well, I'm not sure how I'll get there, but I'll figure out a way. And he says, listen, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to hold the truck for 4 days. I says, well, sir, I'm in on it. He says, that isn't it. He says, I can tell you're interested. He says, I'm going to hold the truck for 4 days. He says, I'm putting a hold on it right now. There's two other trucks that I also had found earlier on. I said, okay, Lord, I don't got the means to go there, and I don't have a car to get there. I go to church that morning, and a little tiny church. There's an evangelist speaking. The pastor stands up afterwards and he says, we'll take care of the evangelist, but right now we'll take care of Brother Barnes. He says, the Lord told me that he needs a car to go look at some trucks. And he says, this church is going to finance that car. He says, they're going to rent that car, and we need to rent him a car for a week. And we need to pay for it. I didn't ask for nothing. Not nothing. My phone rings and says, Brother Barnes, we're gathering $2,000 together so you can put it down on the truck. It's on my way down to Oregon. I'm talking about a field being planted. And I'm talking about a harvest coming for me. As I drive and I take off and I stop and I pick up the money and I'm headed across and I'm headed in Idaho, so I don't want you to look at the other two trucks. That truck is your truck. Now everybody told me, oh, you got to ask for such and such. You need to tell the Lord what you want. I said, not of what. I said, I've had traders. I've had God drop whatever I need. I don't need to tell God what I want. I need to accept God, whatever God wants to bring me. And I'm looking at this one, and I pull up to this truck in the middle of the night. I said, you know what? Let's go look at this truck. We'll find it on a lot. Let's go look at it. I look at it. It's got a $4,000 bumper on it that I've wanted for 10 years. It's all leather, heated seats. We get in it the next day. I look up, and there's a sunroof in the top of it. I said, oh, my goodness. Lord, said, this is your truck. I said, Lord, I can't afford this truck. But I know you can. I get out of the office and he says, what do you think? I said, run my credit. I'm thinking I'm in that zone of good, fair. I'm up above fair, up above good. And I'm thinking, okay, Lord. He says, the interest is going to be about it.
percent on a reused vehicle. That's really not a lot, whether anybody realizes it or not. And the truck was 10 years old. Had 103,000 miles on it. Well, these diesel, I got another one out here with almost 600,000. I run them hard and I run them long. And God runs them long. I'm saying something on purpose. Because see, in the midst of all this, there's a plowing going on. There's a field being plowed. And there's a harvest coming forth. But if I won't let God finish harvesting the field, then I'm going to miss out on God has.
Yep.
I hope somebody's getting something out of this tonight. He said, I'm standing, I'm thinking, okay, all right, Lord. And I said, Lord, the only thing I like, Lord, I really like it down between that 5 and 6%. I know it's a used truck. So they run my credit. Said it'll be about 45 minutes. 45 minutes goes by, an hour goes by, an hour and a half goes by. I walk in Walmart, and I hear the Holy Spirit say, you call Ron where he's at. You tell him to get interceding. You tell him, you look across, and you call Calvin, and you start crying out. And I started crying out in Walmart at the top of my lungs. I started praying in the Spirit. I walked outside the door. My phone rang and said, Dave, you got it. I walked back to the office, and what I seen, I couldn't believe it. He says, I don't know how you got this, but you got 5.49 interest. I'm saying, thank you, citizen. What am I saying to you? I'm saying that God brings forth a harvest. I'm saying that God begins something. I'm saying that the harvest is plenteous. But pray ye therefore for the Lord of the harvest to send forth the harvesters. To send forth the laborers into the field, into your field. Because if your field comes forth, you know, it's supposed to come forth, you'll be able to reach the others. We picked up the truck and rolled back. And I thank God for the blessing. I'm saying something on purpose. I want us to get a hold of something. See, we're busy living. I'm not telling you to go get in debt. That's not what I said. I said God gave me a specific thing to do. And see, we hear God says something to us, and what we often don't do, we don't go do it. And then we wonder why we haven't got the blessing. And you know what? Sometimes God don't speak more than three times. And that's real. Because as you mature in God, He expects more of you. Whom much is given, much is required. I'm talking about a harvest that God is trying to bring. I'm talking about coming forth in a place. But I'm talking about that. And I had to press. I have a wife with Alzheimer's. I have all these things going on. I can't be without a vehicle. I know God's a healer. That's not it. And it ain't because I don't believe. It's because I'm going to be tried in the reign of words. I'm going to be tried in it. Am I going to be found lacking? Am I not going to be able to stand in the faith caliber that God is wanting me to stand if I won't take the hold and let God bring me through what needs to come through? Let Him put the fire under me that needs to be put under me. Let Him bring forth what needs to come forth. If I won't, then how can I say that I am one who is led by the Spirit of God? But in the same chapter, it said that we come to a place in Romans 8 and 11. But if the Spirit of Him that raised Jesus from the dead dwell in you, He that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by the Spirit that dwelleth in you.
Praise God.
I'm saying something. See, part of what God is trying to do is get us to raise up in the Holy Spirit. Get us to come forth in the Holy Ghost. There's a lot of scripture I can quote. But it don't mean nothing unless I quote it only when God says it. Otherwise, it's empty. I've got to learn to obey God in the smallest thing.
That's right.
The little, tiny thing. The thing that seems so religious. And you know what happens? Often, the little, tiny thing is the thing that seems to make the biggest reward. See, we can see the big thing.
See, I've been accused of. Yeah, well, Brother Barnes, I bet you don't even go to the bathroom until the Holy Ghost tells you. Sometimes. Close your eyes. I'm seeing something on purpose. The little tiny things, it's the little foxes that spoil the vine. It's the little tiny things that don't allow the harvest to come forth. It's what burns up the field. You know what happens in a wheat field or a corn field when it's right out of the bringing it to harvest? Often there's a fire that sets off and it burns up acres and acres and thousands of acres, takes out machinery, takes out everything there is. It burns at a rate of speed of sometimes over 125 miles an hour. Sorry, the combine don't go that fast. We're going to have an awful hepped up chapter to get out of that one. I'm saying something on purpose. See, sometimes if we're not careful, I allow the wrong feed in my field and my crop becomes a flame. It's burnt to the ground, and that which God meant to be a harvest was not a harvest because I quit just before.
Yep.
Just before the blessing run, just before the revival started, just before, my Lord, I'm tired, and God says, so what? And we can't handle hearing God say, so what?
Just saying.
Just saying.
So what?
See that place that God wants to bring us to, that same spirit that raised Christ Jesus from the dead shall quicken. My Lord God.
Amen.
Weary and tired, hurt and hardly able to drive, and my shoulders bother me, and I'm under the trailer, and I come out from underneath the trailer, and here comes two girls. I encouraged them, but they also encouraged me. Never one time have I ever seen God begin to manifest His Spirit, and they be encouraged, and He not encouraged me too. Not one single time in my life. Sometimes we just rather be discouraged. What do you say? I'll say it again. Sometimes I just rather be discouraged. Anybody ever been there? Hanging on to my discouragement so I can feel sorry for my bad self.
Just a couple days ago, Brother Barnes. Just Calvin, too.
What you see, what you get out of me. I'm not going to mix words. Because God mixing words wouldn't help me. It was God just being torn blind to me. If you and I don't think we ever need encouragement and strengthening, I can apply myself to the Word. I can pray and pray and pray and pray and pray. And I seem to see God. And sometimes I just can't hardly get up out of it. But God sends one person my way.
And then boom.
And it all is. Anybody ever had that happen?
Yep. Many times.
Anybody getting what I'm saying? See, He's going to try you in rhema word. See, because what happens is I get in, and the reason I can't come up is because I'm in the Logos. Anybody getting what I'm saying? There's a word. This is a written book. And I'm going to say it, and I don't care, Facebook, if you get offended. If you do, I advise you get up off your dead bed and go to the altar. Until the Spirit reveals, this is a dead letter. And that is a thus saith the Lord. When the Holy Spirit begins to really reveal, it brings forth life. But until then, it does what? It begins to bring forth something. See, I want to know the Word. I love the Word. But I've got to realize there's a difference between a Word and the Word. The Word, which comes out of the oracle of God. In the beginning, Jesus was the Word. But not was He just the Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with Him. And He was the Word. Or He is the Word. That same Spirit that dwelled in you, that dwelled in Christ Jesus, shall quicken your mortal body. That same Word that is live, that same Rhema Word, that same Rhema Word of power, shall quicken your mortal body. Just because you read a scripture doesn't mean God brings it. Anybody ever open their Bible, they're going along and you're going through something, all of a sudden, boom, whoa, and it comes up off of the page at you? That's a rhema word. But have you ever been in a place where you just read and read and it seems like it just doesn't lift? It's because God's trying to get you to do something else. And if you've never been there, then you've never been in the Holy Ghost. Hello? Hello, because sometimes God's got to drive me to the wilderness. You know what that means? That means sometimes He's got to allow some things to get heavy to drive me to the wilderness. So that I'll cry out. He's got to put me in a place that I'll cry out unto God. You're letting the sides down, Calvin. I'm saying something on purpose. See, that same Spirit that shall raise Christ Jesus from the dead shall quicken your mortal body. Those that are led by the Spirit, they are the children of God. You know what's happening? I said, all right, Lord, I know you told me that there's something fixing to happen in Columbia Falls, Klamath, or Kalispell, Montana. Now, this is actually my fifth trip right here. This is the third time that I've stayed a season. But never have I felt or seen the Holy Spirit like I see it now. Never. See, there was a season of 11 years that God had sent me through to be part of a plow plowing the field. I have had more people come to me with a dream, with a vision, with something that felt in my spirit that God is fixing to pour it out right here. I'm saying something on purpose. You see, if we don't come to the place that we begin to realize that we must, and that when we say led, that means sometimes I got to drop everything I planned. And boy, we want to be. See, I came to a season and I couldn't get my bills paid on time. Well, religion got all over me. One day I'm praying and the Lord says, why don't you just let me have it and go ahead and call your debtors and just tell them you're on the spot. So as I started calling my debtors to tell them I'm in a spot, my phone started ringing from the other direction. Sir, it looks like that you may be in a hard position. Is that why you're not able to make these payments? I said, yeah. He says, well, we're going to extend that loan out. We're going to drop you back and give you 6 months before you've got to make another payment. I didn't have that once. I had that happen about 7 times. And it kept my credit good. I'm saying something on purpose. See, we won't wait on the hand of God. We're not willing to give Him the time to do what He needs to do. He just doesn't come in and He'll just harvest like that. See, today they got 40-foot heads on harvesters. 40-foot wide. One path, 40-foot wide. They run at 22 miles an hour. That's moving, man. That's smoking.
That's harvesting, yep.
Rabbits ain't got a chance. Snakes ain't got a way. Everything, anything in his path is going through that combine. I'm saying something on purpose. Because see, I want God to be able to bring in His 40-foot harvest. I want Him to be able to bring in His mats. And Lord, if I need to humble myself, as the Bible says, humble myself and pray and seek your face and turn from my wicked ways. Then He says, I shall hear from heaven, forgive your sins, and heal your land. Then it says, then my eyes shall be opened, my ears attend unto the prayers within this place. If I can come out of the realm and not keep quit thinking that when I'm in my own junk, that God just hears my prayer. Sometimes we feel like the heavens are brass because the heavens are brass. Because God's trying to get me to adjust. Because God's trying to get me to move into. He's trying to allow him. I need to allow him to come in with his Holy Ghost tractor and plow my field. See, there's a plow that is set forth, and it actually gets down somewhere near 48 inches deep. It sinks into the ground and it rolls up the soil up over from underneath, and it brings it up to the top of the surface, because down deep there's nourishment. Am I with me? And what he's trying to do is get the dirt overturned to a place that the nourishment comes to the top. Then the disc comes through and the things that come through and break up the dirt clod and on and on down the line. But in the natural, the old way to get rid of the weeds is plow it 7 to 8 times. As soon as you see the little green sprouts starting to sprout, you get out the tractor and the plow and you run that field again. And sometimes my field's got to be plowed more than once. Sometimes something's got to happen more than once. Sometimes there's more dirt clod. Sometimes the rocks need to be taken out of my field. Sometimes another. Because see, God is trying to bring forth a harvest, but he's also trying to plant a new field. This is a good word. It's rhema because it's on the spot. Because it ain't nothing I planned. I didn't even look at it. See, walking under that unction and under the power of the Holy Ghost is what brings change to life. Why is it you see so many that have so much word, but yet they're such a mess? I'm getting ready to close. Because they haven't yet received that rhema, Holy Ghost word. It's the rhema, Holy Ghost word. It's the Holy Ghost, the anointing that destroys the yoke. As I walked into your store, and I could feel a heaviness because God was showing me where some things were at. But I could feel the glory of God. And I felt heaven come down. You with me? Don't get hung up and lost in what we're thinking. Let God plow with you. Let God plow what needs to be plowed. Let him harvest what needs to be harvested. And it ain't harvested in your time. It's harvested in his time. Amen. There's right. A time that you either harvest the right time or the harvest fades away. Don't let the winds of doctrine, the doctrines of men, and the winds of all these things come through and blow down your crop like this happened in Iowa and happened in Nebraska. Laid down, they lost about 45% of their crop. Because they had hurricane-style winds inland. God brings us to a certain place that we begin to look and we begin to wonder, Lord, what are you going to do with us? As I close, just think about this. How many of us know that God's trying to plant a new crop in our field? Is it the crop you want, or is it the crop the Holy Ghost wants? We need to have what he wants. See, there's things in your life that God's trying to bring you up to another level. Those are areas of harvest. There's things that happened out of the truck growing up. There's things that happened out of the breakdowns. There's things that have occurred from my wife even having Alzheimer's that I've watched God bring forth a harvest. The word I read says that all that is meant for evil shall be turned to good. See, I love the word.
But I don't like it. I'm supplied wrong. I see revival on the horizon. But it's up to us. The Holy Spirit is already saying. I'm going to share one story and then I'm going to close. I was in Phoenix, Arizona. I was going to a church that I was preaching every third week. The Lord begins to do something, begins to deal something. We see a revival in the children, in the kids. We had a night of meetings, and the kids begin to prophesy. The kids begin to speak to one another. People were laid out. The kids were laid. The young people were laid all over the floor. And a lot of them were the ones who were in the place. The power of God swept. Another time I'm standing there and I'm coming in and I'm going to preach that night, and I watch, all of a sudden I look up and I see the throne of God, and I see crystals rolling, and all of a sudden I look up and I realize it's coming to this church. And when it hit the church, all those on the podium were not flat. Instruments went poof, all over the place, but never hit nobody. By the way, this is a Baptist church. I watched it sweep across the congregation and lay every person out. Some of them were great Baptists over their people. The Holy Ghost swept a young girl who had wanted the Holy Ghost, who had not yet received the Holy Ghost, come to her feet and begin to speak in tongues. She stood up on the back of the pew. And I'm like, do I bring this down, Lord? And I'm preaching along, and I realize she's bringing forth a word. I realize that what's happening is I'm bringing forth the interpretation of the word out of a little girl who just received the Holy Ghost just moments earlier. Then I received that for an hour and a half. I preached a word from the Holy Ghost that was interpreted as she stood on the back. You ever try to stand on the back of a pew? It's a little wider than that. And the power of God swept this place. It swept it. But because of some old fogey, afterwards says, oh, I don't know. And we brought the 10 and God hit again. And in the middle of the night, in the middle of the revival, God said, pull this tent down now. Pack it up and roll out. They have been doing their own thing. They have been trying to control the music. They've been wanting to do whatever they want to do. And God says, pull it down now. I packed it up. Ron and I packed it up. We put it in the trailer, headed down the road, and God took us to another church about 300 miles away. By the time dawn arrived, it was on a Saturday night. I said, Lord, what happened there? I still stayed friends with him. I said, Lord, what happened there? I cried out for months, and as I drove down off of the hill out in Bridgeport, California, I looked up again and again. I seen the crystals, and I'm sharing this for a reason. I seen the crystals, and the Lord says, I sent revival to and fro across this nation to see who will take my revival. The Lord said, but that question that you asked about that church, I will never, ever, ever send revival again. I sent it to them 3 times. They refused it. I will never send it again. See, we fail to see the judging hand of God. There's something happening here. I'm not rebuking this tonight. I'm telling you that God's plowing our field. I'm telling you that there's a harvest. I'm telling you got something. I'm telling you have something. I'm telling you, sis, you got something. See, we got to let it out. We got to let God bring forth a harvest out of us. If we'll do that, I promise you, there's something on the horizon. And just end up at a barbershop. Yeah, I know Phil's not good. It's the Holy Ghost that really put me there.
Yep.
You see, we were meant to be.
See, when I see your face, you walk in, when I see the things that come in, you bring it quick. You bring it quick. See, because what does it mean? One can put 1,000 to fire and two can put 10,000 to fire. It means as we come together in unity, as we come together united, not in unity as a creature, there's power. And what's happening, and why has God all of a sudden this trip, not the last trip, not the trip before, the trip before that, how come all of a sudden I just seem to randomly run into people, including somebody in the bank teller, that's got to tell me, I had a dream! I can see a few of the tellers in the back going, oh no, there she goes again. God is bringing forces. Lord God, I ask you, Lord, to see
thank you, Jesus.
In our hearts.
Thank you, Lord.
Father God, let us allow you to plow our field.
Thank you, Lord.
But let us allow you to bring forth the harvest
that
will come forth in us. Let us not think and let me not believe that I have it all, Lord. But Lord, you said, if my people will call for my name, will humble themselves in Christ, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven, forgive their sins, and give their land. And now my eyes shall be opened, and my ears attentive to prayer. 2 Chronicles 7:14. What am I saying? Oh Lord, pour out upon us this time. Lord, I know you've already started something, and I know that your spirit tried to hit me. I know that it tried to hit Scott. I know that it tried to hit my sister. I know that it's trying to hit. But Lord, right now, I bind every principality. I cancel every assignment from the north to the east to the south of the world. I speak life and life more abundantly, pressed down, taken together, and coming over. Lord, we are the head, not the tail. We are above, not beneath. We have the power to tread upon serpents and scorpions, over all the powers of the enemy, and nothing by any means shall harm us. Lord, you said that if we submit unto you and resist the devil, he shall flee. But Lord, allow not us to be taken in discouragement. Lord, even though discouragement may roll, even that place that discouragement wants to come, Lord, I ask you, Lord, to put those around us. Bring your word, but Lord, put those around us that become a strength to us. Lord, you said to Peter, when thou art converted, strengthen your brother. If there wasn't discouragement coming, if the body wasn't going to be discouraged, why wouldn't God have called you, Peter? Tell Peter to come to that place when you are converted to strengthen your brother. Oh God, help us. Help us to be that encouragement. Help us to become what you called us to become. Help us, oh God. Hang on. Hang on. The anointing is fixing to destroy the yoke. God's bringing you to a higher place. He's bringing you to another level. Sometimes you wonder, Lord, where am I going? But you've wanted to lean on the hand of the Holy Spirit. And I see the hand of the Holy Spirit on your back. I see him beginning to direct you and put you where you need to be. And I bind the discouragement. I come up against the weariness. I come up against those things in the name of Jesus. I speak life and life more abundantly. Lord God, in your precious name, I see it. She is a joint heir with Christ Jesus. She is the head, not the tail. She is above, not beneath. And Lord, I ask you to bind my faith with her faith. I ask you to put it into play, Lord. And Lord, in the name of Jesus, devil, we give you notice. You have no place. She will be a Holy Ghost walker. She will be one who walks out on the water. I see it, sis. I see you coming to play because you're kind of reserved. You're kind of laid back. You're not always outgoing. But I hear God laying another boldness on you. I hear something getting ready to come forth, sis. It's going to come up out of your belly like a rivers of living water. I hear, I feel it. I can feel the fire burning. John said that there's one who comes before me whose shoes are not even worthy to unlace, but he shall not bear.
baptized me in water, but he shall baptize me in water, in Holy Ghost and fire. I see the Holy Ghost and fire beginning to stir something, sis. I see something beginning to happen. I see something beginning to move in the Holy Spirit. I see a shaking, but let me tell you, through the shaking and through the tribulation, God is bringing patience, and through the patience he is bringing experience, and through the experience he will make you a woman of hope. Woo! Lord God, in your precious name, I thank you, I praise you, I worship you, in Jesus' precious name, in Jesus. Be not wary, I hear it. Be not wary. Be not wary in well-doing, for in due season you shall be. Don't be bothered because you may have been discouraged. Jesus is on the position of the encourager. He is the great physician. Sometimes we need to pray, Lord, send your spirit encouragement, the Lord. Because sometimes where you're walking now, some of you, it can be a lonely place because it seems like no one wants to abide there. Don't be discouraged. Let not your heart be troubled. No, in due season. You shall reap if you faint not. Oh, I wanted to faint. I wanted to quit. I wanted to stop. I wanted to say, what am I doing? Lord God, I thank you and praise and worship in Jesus' precious name. If you need prayer, we're here. Small minds and hearts clear. Lord, thank you. Encourage it. Thank you, sir. Grab somebody and bring them back, not because I'm here.
Hey guys, it's Pastor Scott. Just want to say thank you for joining us. Hope and pray that you enjoy the broadcast. We love you guys. Jesus loves you more. If you need anything at all, give us a call at 1-855-70-JESUS. And I believe we'll be back again tomorrow night for night 3 of the Fathead Valley Revivals. Thank you so much. And if you're in the area here in Columbia Heights, Montana, or planning a visit, come on by the God's Ten Commandment Park and visit and or log on, share, and just visit. We'll be here for you. God bless you. Take care.